Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines, and the Lord has commanded me to make a second video and continue going forward with what I made in the last video I just posted. I advise you to watch. It says, Repent or Be Left Behind. It's the name of the video. This is really like a part two of that, and the Lord has just been dropping scriptures on me more than ever, over and over again, like 100 scriptures, to confirm His Word. The Bible says, let everything be established by two or three witnesses. The Lord has given me 100 witnesses to establish His Word and the meaning of His Word. Okay, quick review. The Lord just keeps dropping it on me like crazy. Here's the point. We're talking about the rapture. We're talking about who will be raptured, who will not be. We're talking about once saved, always saved, or eternal security, as some people call it. And as I said, if you've been a follower of my videos for the last 3 years, 2.5 years, I've been very sympathetic and liberal in my position toward people losing their salvation and people not going in the rapture. Not liberal about sin, but liberal in being sympathetic to the position that if you're really born again, then you're going to go in the rapture. Now, as I said in the last video, the Lord has been correcting me and showing me through dreams, through visions, through quickening in my spirit, through Bible verses for the last several months, moving my position as I've studied and followed the text. The Lord has moved my position to the position that He wants me to see from His Word. Now, people quote Bible verses, brothers and sisters, and they say, you know, that you know, once saved, always saved, and all these kind of things. And if you're, you know, everyone that says they're a Christian is going to go in the rapture. As an example, Paul said, all that call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Call upon the name of the Lord in repentance. So the video I just loaded, the Lord had given me the verse Acts 17:30, which says God calls all men everywhere to repent. Now, you cannot take one Bible verse out of context. You cannot do that. I should have wrote this down. You know, I never do that. I'm so bad about doing that. But I got different arguments that I'm dealing with. I got a pen right here. Okay. One argument that people make. You know, I usually never have notes, but I read. One argument people make is they say that, you know, God never puts His wrath on His people. His people. God never wrath on it. Let me write this down. On someone that's supposed to be His people. Okay, that is blatantly where people come up with these wacky ideas. They're repeating something that somebody else told them. That is totally unbiblical. Okay, let's talk about that first. So I can just keep this in order. Now, I take all the Bible to be the Word of God, okay? Now, there are people who are Judaizers and stuff, and they love to try to throw out. That's the other extreme. People that say you got to follow the law and you got to be perfect to go to heaven and all this. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. Never did. The problem with people is they throw out extremes. Like they say, if someone says, I believe once saved, always saved, then people will say, he believes you can just live in sin, do all you want, and raise hell every day, and be like hell, and do what you want to do, and then you're going to go to heaven. No, there are some people that believe that, but there are people at different levels of seeing that. Okay, and then the same is true with on the Judaizer end. There's people who are extremely safe. You're not perfect, you're not going to heaven, which all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But there are people along the line of holiness who know that they have to walk by faith and not by sight, and it's by grace are we saved through faith. Grace to what? Grace to repent. God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. So when we humble ourselves and repent and lower ourselves, those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Now, that being said, let's look at the Apostle Paul. Listen to this. You have to take the whole Bible. I mean, you have to listen to the message, not one Bible verse out of context. This is what Paul, Paul is the person whose text people use more than anybody's to support once saved, always saved. They take that and run with it. Now, let's see what Paul said. Listen to what he says. The Lord is just dropping them on me like crazy. And then, Paul's talking about some Old Testament stuff. Listen to this. Moreover, brethren, talking to the church. This is in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Excuse me. He's talking to the church at Corinth, not to the world. Excuse me. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant. And that's what it is, ignorance. how that all of our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. He's talking about the Red Sea, you know, with Pharaoh chasing them. And we're all baptized into Moses, unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink. Now he's getting into talking about communion here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For we drank of that, for they drank, some children of Israel, of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness, like Korah, the sons of Korah. They were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after evil things. We, the church, should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. Neither be ye idolaters, as were some of them. They made the golden calf. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Now that expression, rose up to play, is they had orgy, okay? Drunken revelry. They had a sexual orgy. That's what it's talking about. Just to put that out there for you. The language that's used is, you know, like a euphemism. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed. See, he refers to it there. They were committing fornication, sex outside of marriage. As some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed by the serpents. Who sent the serpents? And Jesus said, you know, even as Moses lifted up the serpent, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up. And if I be lifted up, I'll draw in all men to me. This is an Old Testament witness for you. Who sent the serpents to kill the people that didn't look on the serpent, bit by the snakes? God. It was the wrath of God, the judgment of God. On who? On his people. Now, I'm tired of hearing people say and reading comments of people saying God doesn't send his wrath or his punishment on his own people. Yes, he does. You've obviously never read the Bible. Here it is right here in the New Testament. Paul's talking about it. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed by the destroyer. We're destroyed of the destroyer. God destroyed them. Why? Because they murmured. Don't you murmur. What is... Wake up. Now all these things happen unto them for an example, and they are written for our admonition. Someone told me, they admonish me, that once saved, always saved is true. Here's how ironic that Paul uses the word right here, admonish. Admonish to talk about God will judge his people and bring his wrath upon his people. For an example, that they are written for our admonition upon whom the end of the world are come. Upon whom the ends of the world are come. Now, they were of the end of this age. Okay. Therefore, or wherefore, in the King James, let him that thinketh he stand. That's those people commenting to me and everyone else. Wherefore, let him, once saved, always saved, that thinks he stands, take heed, lest he fall. Now, if it's not possible to lose your salvation, why did Paul say, take heed, at least you fall? What does that mean? Why would Paul say that you could fall like the children of Israel fell if it didn't mean it was possible to fall? Now, people love to quote this next verse and take it out of context. There hath no temptation taken you but such is common to men. But God is faithful, who will not allow you or suffer you to be tempted above what you are able, but will with temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. God's not saying that you won't fall. He's saying that he won't allow you to be tempted about what you can't overcome by your free will. He won't let you be tempted to the point that you lose your free will, and then you're forced to fall, and then somehow it's God's fault because God allowed you to be overrun. And of course you're overrun, so how could God judge you when the temptation was so great that no one could resist? That's what it's saying. It's not saying you won't fall, you can choose to fall. That's what it's saying. Come on, guys. Therefore, my dearly beloved, and this one right here goes to all my Catholic friends, flee from idolatry. You know, I'm so tired of American preachers keep talking about, and it's true, though, but I'm tired of them saying, you know, about idolatry, about money and all that kind of stuff. People have idolatry of a movie star or whatever, blah, blah, blah. That is true to a certain extent, okay? But idolatry means to bow down and adore, to honor don't necessarily mean to worship, but to go look it up in your dictionaries. You will see that it means to bow down in reverence to a man-made object, idolatry. And right here, for all my dearly beloved Catholic friends, it says flee from idolatry. It doesn't say, oh, just ignore that big statue of Mary in the corner. It says flee from idolatry. That means get away from it. Because lightning might strike from God's wrath upon people that's supposed to be his people. I speak as a man, as I speak to wise men. Judge ye what I say. And Paul goes on, he's talking about idolatry. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, and we are partakers of one bread. He goes on and on to say, talking about the idolatry. You know, you can't mix a cup of devils and the cup of the Lord at the Lord's table. Verse 21, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Now, let's keep going. I wanted to jump ahead and I got to come back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. But before I do, the Lord keeps prompting me to look at Romans, brothers and sisters. Romans chapter 11. The Lord just dropped it on me since I've been speaking to you. Okay. This is what Paul's talking about. He's talking about the Israelites being saved, getting a second chance at the end. Romans chapter 11, verse 11. I say then, have they stumbled? He's talking about Israel, that they should fall. God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles, for to provoke them to jealousy. Now, if the fall of them be the riches of the world. Okay, he's talking about that. Listen, I don't want to talk about Israel right now. Everybody keeps talking about Israel. Let's talk about the church at this moment. We're still in the church age. Speaking to you, for I speak to you Gentiles, insomuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office. It's kind of funny how people seem to think that Peter, you know, speaking again about Roman Catholicism, that Peter is somehow the first pope and somehow going to the Gentiles, when the Bible tells us in Acts and then this verse right here and also in Galatians that Peter was appointed the apostle to the circumcision, to Israel, and Paul was appointed the apostle to the Gentile world. So if anybody wanted to be called the first leader of the Gentile church, human is Paul, not Peter, as testified by both of them, Paul and Peter, in the Bible, Acts chapter 15, Galatians, and then here again Paul references it, Romans chapter 11, verse 13. And if by any means I am provoked to emulation them which are my flesh, he's talking about Israel, and might have some of them, let's see. It's talking about, I don't want to talk about Israel right now. I want to talk about how this applies to the Gentile church. Let's see. And if some, he's talking about an olive tree, and he's talking about some of the olive branches are broken off. Verse 17, Romans 11, 17. And if some of the branches are broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, were grafted into among them, some of the Gentiles. We're a wild olive branch that's been grafted into an olive tree. The natural branches of the olive tree were broken off. That's Israelites, because they were in unbelief about Jesus Christ. And were grafted in among them, a wild olive tree, and with them partaketh of the root and the fatness of the olive tree. Boast not against the branches. Don't boast against Israel. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root beareth you. The root, of course, is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which he speaks about earlier in this chapter. That will say then, the branches are broken off, and I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, he rejected the Israelites, who rejected the Messiah. Take heed, lest he also spare not thee. Does that sound like one saved, always saved? One time in a Bible study with a Filipino, the first Filipino church I started, I invited there were some Gentile people who came, or, you know, non-Filipino people that came. And the husband was actually having a relationship with his stepdaughter. She was over 18, but he was having a relationship with his wife and his stepdaughter, and his wife was allowing this, and he even had a child by both of them about the same time. And I tried to help the wife and the stepdaughter. She was grown, like I said. I invited them to the Bible study. They came because I'd met them through some of the Filipinos. And I just read this text that I'm reading to you right now. I didn't even comment at all. I just read the text straight. This guy got berserkly mad and left. Of course, I never even said a word outside what the text says. He was totally convicted that he can't live in sin and all the things he's doing and go to heaven. That's the purpose of the Word of God. Verse 21, for if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, lest he also spare not thee. What does that mean, not spare? Does that mean once saved, always saved? Tell me how it means that. Because the one text verses you use to support the doctrine is the same guy, Paul. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shalt be cut off. I mean, it's Romans chapter 11. How could this be confusing? I can't figure out why this is confusing people. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it's talking about communion. Therefore, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. Wherefore, whoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let every man examine himself, and let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sleep among you, and many sleep. And if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Let's see. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what else to tell you. You can be condemned with the world if you keep taking it unworthily, communion. How can you be a Christian, take it unworthily? There's something you must do. It means to repent. Pray up. 1 John. Let's go to another one of the apostles. 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. I'm trying to use this e-sword on this text. They went out from us, and they were not of us, for if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. But ye have the unction from the Holy Spirit, Holy One, and ye know all things. I have not written unto you because ye know not the truth, but because ye know it, that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar? He talks about the Antichrist, people that reject the Christ. Let that, verse 24, 1 John 2, 24, let that therefore abide in you which ye have heard from the beginning, remain in you. Why is he saying to let it remain in you if it's once saved, always saved? Then it's gonna. Why would you be told? We need to be told to abide. Jesus Himself, when He talks about being the true vine, John chapter 15, He said, "Abide in Me, and I in you. Apart from Me, you can do nothing. Any branch that's withered will be thrown into the fire and burnt." I mean, what do these things mean? I mean, what could it mean? Therefore, abide in you. The gospel, therefore, abide in you, which ye have heard from the beginning, that ye which have heard from the beginning shall remain, from that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you. Ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he hath promised us, even eternal life. These things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. Now, if we can't lose our salvation, what about people seducing you? People seducing you away to stop abiding in Christ? If you can't lose your salvation, why would we need to be told that? But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you, but that same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and there's no lie, even it has been taught to you. Ye shall abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If ye knew that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Doeth righteousness. Now, I've been going through several of these texts as I've just been reading to you, as the Lord has been dropping them on me. Boom, boom, boom. I have many more texts. Now let's talk about Luke 21:36, Jesus talked about the tribulation. He said, watch therefore and pray that you be accounted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Be counted worthy to escape these things. To be counted worthy. That's the word I'm talking about. Being worthy. 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 Now let's look. Now this is what I made that last video, and then the Lord began to drop all these things on me more and more detail. Witnesses. Because I, you know, the Lord knows. I didn't think about it, but the Lord knows that, you know, the enemy's not is going to get all fired up about this message. There's also the parable of the 10 virgins. Okay? The Lord has confirmed to me over the last several months. I've made videos in the past saying that I didn't think that that's what it meant. But that's what it means. There are five virgins who are wise, who have their oil, who are abiding in Christ, who will enter into the marriage supper of the Lamb. The other five, the Lord said, I never knew you. It is talking about those abiding in Christ. It's, those 10 virgins are the church. I made a video before saying I thought I'd know what it was. It's possible it could be Israel. Haven't really heard from the Lord that much about it. But the Lord has told me and spoken to me over the last several months through dreams, visions. If you've been watching my videos, I've been, you know, evolving and adapting my teaching as the Holy Spirit has led me. That's what it's all about. You know, not every single topic. I don't know every single topic. Nobody knows every single topic. Some things I've looked at, some things have happened. I'm only looking at the things that the Lord leads me to look at. You can't possibly know every single doctrine about every single thing. You can just go one at a time. Most people just keep spouting what they've heard. I learned all kinds of stuff in Bible school. You know, I've got 5 years of Bible school. I have a minor in Old Testament theology, and my major, of course, is missionology, which is, of course, is the same as a pastor, except for you do it cross-cultural communications. But 90% of it's the same as what any pastor would take from Assemblies of God. But, you know, I take all that stuff with a grain of salt. Anything I learned in Bible school, I took it all with a grain of salt. This is some man's opinion. So, you know, some of it is anointed and came from God. Some of it came from some hierarchy structure. Some of it even came all the way back from the Catholic Church or whatever. You know, this hasn't been reformed yet. You know, it depends. It depends. So, you know, it's all open to be led by the Spirit. As I just read from the text from John, 1 John chapter 2, you know, we don't need any man to teach us. We're led by the Spirit. There's tons of people, 99% of the people, they don't know the Word and they're not led by the Spirit. So yes, you do need somebody to teach you if you haven't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, for sure. Now that's a whole nother teaching I need to get into. People out here that's talking about, like Mike Hoggard. I mean, he looks great. He's got a suit. He's got glasses. He looks like he's smart, blah, 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 whatever. The guy blasphemes the Holy Spirit almost every video. And he doesn't believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. That doesn't make him not a Christian. Blaspheming the Holy Spirit? That's a whole other matter. It's called the unforgivable sin. Now, and I don't know to say that he's, in my opinion, he needs to be careful. He seems as if he's blaspheming the Holy Spirit. So anybody that's not filled with the Holy Spirit, you're wasting your time listening to them. You're wasting your time listening to them. What we just read from John, he's talking about he who abideth in you. He's talking about the power of the Holy Spirit. That's a whole other topic. Let me stay on topic. Revelation 3:10. Listen to this. Jesus wrote seven letters. He had dictated seven letters to the Apostle John to seven different churches. And one out of seven, Jesus said this, because I have kept the word of my patience. In the modern English, it's you have patiently kept my word. I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation that shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. That's the tribulation. All men on the whole earth. Now, I read this in the last video and I talked about it. And I said that, you know, it's only one out of seven churches and, excuse me, all these other churches he didn't say it to. And then, you know, I've been reading people's comments and saying stuff like, well, not on that video, other videos I've made, that as the Lord has been progressively giving me this revelation, saying that, you know, we're going in the, if you're saved, you're going in the rapture. There's no Bible verse that says, oh, if you're saved, you're once saved, always saved. It doesn't say that. And then secondly, it doesn't say if you're really saved that you're going into rapture. It doesn't say that either. So it's two different things. Salvation and the rapture are mutually exclusive. I mean, nobody said, oh, just because you said you're saved, you're going into rapture. It doesn't say that. Moreoverly, the words that's been spoken on that topic is by Jesus right here, where he says to one out of seven churches, because thou hast patiently kept my word. Now, the thing that the Lord quickened in my spirit to why I started making this new video is this very sentence that Jesus said. He didn't say, because you believe in me, You will be kept out of the hour of temptation that shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. No, he said, because you have patiently kept my word. You're teaching a works salvation. Jesus, you're teaching a work salvation, Jesus. You better watch out. You better take that before the deacons of the First Hardshell Baptist Church of goingtohell.com. Because Jesus is falsely teaching in this text that you must keep his word patiently in order to go in the rapture. And not everyone will be raptured, but just those people that fall in the category of the Church of Philadelphia. Didn't Jesus read those Bible verses that other people are quoting? What's wrong with Jesus? Why is he talking about 10 virgins and 5 being wise and 5 being unwise, but yet they're still virgins? They're virgins who are part of the, you know, of the bridal party. 5 of them are wise and 5 are unwise. Jesus says to 5 of them, I never knew you. And 5 go with him into the wedding. Didn't Jesus get the memo of, you know, of the statement of faith of all of these denominations that said that no matter what you do, live like hell, raise Cain, raise hell all day long, say a prayer one time, just give a mental assent that Jesus is the Christ and you're going to heaven, and then you're going in the rapture, if they believe in the rapture. I mean, lots of the old denominations, there's old Protestants and the Catholics, and lots of it's just allegoric. As a matter of fact, they came from St. Augustine, all this allegoric interpretation. Oh, the 144,000, you know, that's part is literal. There's 144,000 witnesses, but that they're from the tribes of Israel is allegoric. You know, we split sentences. Half the sentence is literal. There's 144,000, and then half the sentence is allegoric because it's not really the Israelites. It's really us. You know, we replace Israel. You know, the replacement theology people. That's your old mainline Protestant denominations. Lots of Catholic doctrines, and then of course, the people on YouTube saying they're one of the 144,000 witnesses. They're doing all that replacement theology and all this allegory mixed in with literal in the same sentence. Wacky, wacky stuff, brothers and sisters. Anyway, as I mentioned about, I'm not going to get off on a tangent on that. You need to learn the word yourself. And I mentioned it the other day. This is straight from the Lord. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So you can, the word of the Apostle John, 2 John chapter 2, can be true in you, that you don't need any man to teach you. Now, I'm on here not to lead people in my own doctrines, but to lead you, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, that you will become, you know, the perfected one new man, you know, that we would all come together as one new man. So as a preacher, as a servant of God, a real servant of God, not a self-appointed person, there's lots of people, not even preachers, not even called by God, nothing on YouTube, saying all kinds of wacky stuff to get people to follow them, to build their numbers. They're showmen, show off, just as I said, a mile wide and an inch deep, all this foolishness, sensationalism on YouTube. The purpose of a pastor and a preacher, besides people getting born again and called to repentance and all that stuff, is to disciple people, that people can follow the Lord on their own. What you're talking about, like as a view of a shepherd. You're telling the sheep, go back there. You know, Jesus is the head shepherd, the good shepherd. And someone, it's an assistant to him, is saying to the sheep, no, he's over there. Get back over there and follow him, follow him, follow him. Pointing people to follow the good shepherd. That's the biggest thing that you're going to discover on the internet and even in churches. Is people saying, follow our church, follow our church, follow our church. Or follow me, look at me, ha ha ha. You know, jump on the bandwagon of the cornfield clown and all this stuff. It's just, it ain't even no gospel in there. It's all a bunch of foolishness. I'm tired of hearing it. People who are practicing divination, looking at tea leaves, staring in crystal balls, looking at upside down drawings and pyramids and all this other stuff, and giving a false gospel that we're half angel, half fallen angel, half man, that we're Nephilim. That is totally unbiblical, and people can't even know the difference. And I thank God, if you're watching this video, that you get off the bandwagon of the silly foolishness and stop following people, stop following denominations, stop following religion, and stop following divination people, and start following the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. Start following him, obeying him. He said, because you have patiently kept my word. Then you're going to get raptured before the tribulation begins. Now, you need to patiently keep his word. So how can you keep his word if you don't read his word? How can you keep his word if you're not empowered by his spirit to do that? So those who want to deny the power of the Holy Spirit, who have a form of godliness, deny the power thereof, go for it. If you want to be empowered to be a witness and to truly follow Christ and abide in him and remain in him and keep his word patiently, be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now, lots of people ask me that about that. I've made videos in the past. You can search my channel, Holy Spirit. I'll make a new video about it as the Lord leads me, how to be receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it's, as I said, that's the word, is to receive it. You need to receive it. God doesn't give it anew, just like salvation. God didn't give you salvation individually. He gave it to the world. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God gave his Son. So we receive salvation, the finished work of Christ. The Holy Spirit was given on the day of Pentecost. So you receive it. Healing was given. By his stripes we are healed. So we receive healing. We receive answers to our prayer. The provision has already been given through the covenant God made through the blood of his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, I'm changing up topics a little bit and going with this other thing that's pressing from the Lord that needs to be put out there. We are so very close to the rapture of the church. And the deception is unbelievably high, going more and more. Now, you cannot have Jesus without the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of God draws people to Christ. You cannot deny these people, as I mentioned before, John MacArthur. There are people who worship him, idolize him as a god. That's great. He is a band leader of saying that, you know, it's not about experiences. Mike Hogard. It's not about experiences. It's about just reading the Bible. They have bread but no living water. The Bible says the letter of the law brings death, you know, but the Spirit brings life. It quickens it. When you read the Word, the Bible says the Word is spiritually discerned. It's by the Holy Spirit of God that is quickened in your mind. If you didn't have an experience with God, you can't get saved without an experience with God. If you just heard the gospel and said, well, I believe Jesus is Christ, that is mental assent. You're agreeing mentally in your human soul, your id, your human soul. You have your body, physical body, your soul, and your spirit, or the Bible calls it your heart most of the time, your heart, your spirit man. You agree in your mind Jesus is Christ, he died on the cross. Great. That's mental assent. That's not salvation. Salvation is an experience where deep calls unto deep. God draws you. Jesus said, no man can come to me unless the Father draws him. Don't let anybody tell you, there's so many people that intellectually believe in Jesus. And that is really the killer problem. I need to make videos about that. As I mentioned, John Wesley taught that 300 years ago. That there's tons of people that mentally agree that Jesus is the Christ, but they're not born again. They're false converts. It's just an outward thing. They didn't get the inside of their cup cleaned, as Jesus said. They're like a whitewashed tomb, you know, a sepulcher. It's white on the outside, but inside full of dead man's bones. First you must clean the inside of the cup, then the outside will be clean also. And that's religion versus truly following Christ. I could go on and on. I'm cautioning you. I'm warning you. I don't care. Brothers and sisters, if you've been watching my videos, I don't care who likes my videos or doesn't like them. It doesn't. Only thing that moves me, really moves me, is the Lord's will. And the hour is late. The time is near for the rapture to happen and the tribulation to begin. And it's all the fun and games and grinning and laughing and shouting cliches and all this silly foolishness. Those times are not upon us. We're not in the carefree days of the 1950s in the United States anymore for Americans. Post-World War II baby boomer people. Those days are over with. We are in the times perilous times are upon this earth. We are living in perilous times, and people need Jesus. People need to get saved. People need to be saved, and we need to stop sugarcoating. And 99%, you want sugarcoating? Hey, you know, they're already off the air now. The Crystal Cathedral's gone now. It's been sold because, they got rid of his son who tried to start preaching the gospel. They got rid of him, Robert Schuller Jr., because he tried to introduce the gospel. Hey, they got rid of him. And the Lord closed the place up. But you got Joel Osteen. You're on the wrong channel if you want your ears tickled. You got Joel Osteen, and you got breaking news on YouTube. you got that stuff, if that's what you want. But if you want to get go be discipled, if you want to grow in your walk with the Lord, if you want to, the Bible says God's desire is to conform us to the image of Christ, to become like Jesus. And it's not through keeping up with latest headlines. It's by prayer and fasting and reading the Word and seeking and asking and knocking the Lord on the Lord's door and calling upon His name and seeking Him, not all these things of the world. You know, I'm just going to get more and more serious, and I'm going to be less and less compromising with all this clowning around. Now, there's nothing wrong with telling a joke. That's a whole other thing. It's part of an illustration. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about being a jerk. People confuse. The problem is like there's a guy on YouTube who is not a preacher. He's a self-appointed guy who raises money, you know, and he goes around the internet bashing everybody. As an example, this guy confuses, just like Joel Osteen, they confuse the love of the world with the love of Christ. The best way you can say it is tough love. God gives tough love. That's why He tells us repent. Not because God is a killjoy that doesn't want people to have a good time, but because this will harm you. Practicing sodomy is harmful to you physically. Your body's not designed to practice sodomy. There's hepatitis, AIDS, and all that stuff now. I guess hepatitis has been around since the beginning, since the fall of man. All those sins, it's not about having a good time. There's people that want to have human love. They confuse it with God's love. More like a parental love. The agape love of God, of course, is sacrificial love and a tough love. This is the way. Walk in this way. You walk in these other ways, go down here and play in the middle of the road, you're going to get run over. You don't tell your children, oh, I love you so much, go play in the middle of the road. No, you warn people. I don't care. I'm telling you right now, I'm going to say up front, I'm going to get more hardcore as the Lord has commanded me to. And I don't care what people think. I don't care if people making videos about me or not making videos about me. It don't matter to me what they say or don't say. They've missed the gospel because they're looking at worldly love, a Joel Osteen kind of thing. That's not the message of the gospel. That's the message of the world. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, not everyone who says they're saved are saved. That's a fact. That is a fact. As Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, went into the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father, the Lord just gave me another one. And the whole video I've been making. Except, I believe that's Matthew chapter 7. And I can't remember the verse. Is it 27? Go look it up. Matthew chapter 7. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, went into the kingdom of heaven. But he that does the will of my Father. Now, does that sound like... does that really sound like just say a prayer or even mentally agree and then you're saved? I mean, why are people keep ignoring that? Why? Because they want to live in sin, I guess. They're trying to sleep at night because their old evil daddy, they don't want to believe their old evil daddy went to hell because he said he was a prayer when he was 10 years old and then was a drunk the rest of his life and never darkened the door of a church and never read his Bible, never prayed. And then they don't want to accept the fact that maybe he went to hell. I mean, maybe that's their problem. I don't know. I mean, maybe they're trying to substitute the agape love of God with the human love, with the antichrist love, you know. Unity. Unity in the world. You know, it's just all one love, one world, one unity. You know, that's the message of the false prophet. You know, we're all children of God. Really, the Bible says that Jesus gives a power to people who believe in Him or are followers of His to become the sons of God. Sons of God in the New Testament is people who are born again. That's what the New Testament says. It says that people that are not Christians and they're not part of the nation of Israel are aliens and enemies of God. The Bible says those who love the world are enemies of God. Wow. Enemy doesn't sound like a child of God. And you know, I can just go on and on. The Lord has just dropped so much stuff on me, guys. It's just so blatantly simple. I'm confounded by people. But like I said, that's the Lord's problem, not mine. The Lord is responsible for people. I mean, all I can do is just do my little part, which make the videos. I love you guys. You know I'm being facetious, to use one of those big $5 words. And I think I pronounced it right. I must be doing pretty good. I pronounced it right. And God bless you guys. I appreciate all of your the viewers. And I appreciate, you know, those who have prayed for Joshua's ministry. As I said, people confuse when you rebuke and do a hard video that you hate people or somehow like that. It's not true. I love the Lord with all my heart, and then his people. I love the Lord's people and who the Lord leads me to make a video to. Now, people get confused and they mix up these types of love. That's a whole nother video, like I said. There's a sister who's been messaging with me for a couple of years who lives in the United Kingdom. She's dealing with the same thing. All these fake Christians who are confusing human love with God's love. Joel Osteen's the best example. Or even, look. Joel Osteen has the largest church in America because he tickles people's ears. He's giving the message of the world on YouTube. And I don't care. I qualify this by saying, I would like to have viewers. Of course, because I know that the Lord's using me to get more people the message. But serving the Lord is not a popularity contest. There are people on here, you know, as an example, maybe their wife is a Catholic. And so they're tickling people's ears, guys. They're tickling people's ears, and that's why they're popular. But lots of people are watching them just to laugh and joke at them. They're not watching them because they're listening to what they say. As a matter of fact, they're just mocking them and laughing at them. Having the largest YouTube channel doesn't mean you're a success in Christ. It means you're a success in the world, 99%. Just like Noah. Noah, brothers and sisters. No one got on the ark but his family. And, you know, by the world standard, he was a failure. Now, I'm not being fatalistic and defeatist in saying that, you know, I have lots of viewers. Praise God for everyone. But I'm not here. What I'm trying to say, and for me, not just for me, I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about you too. And like the sister in the UK who's dealing with all these alleged Christians, nominal Christians, people who are not really Christians actually, who say that, even like my relatives claim they're Christians and they're pro-gay marriage, pro-abortion and all this kind of stuff. Look, that is a perfect example of black and white examples of compromise that is ungodly and blasphemous. I'm trying to keep you, just like me, from me. I'm talking to myself, too. I'm preaching to the choir myself, that we don't compromise, brothers and sisters. We are running a race with patience. We want to finish this race, get raptured, and get out of here. We have to be kind of worthy. Don't compromise. We have to give an account for everything we say. If you're out there talking to your neighbor and you say, oh, yeah, it's okay to be gay, blah, blah. The Lord heard you say that. Just because you're not on YouTube and 3,000 people aren't watching you, or whatever, or 100,000 people aren't watching you, it doesn't matter. You have to give an account for that. You have to give an account for that. So that's why I'm trying to tell you, stop compromising. It's not about me. I'm using myself as an example. There'll be someone to comment, oh, Pastor Padgett, don't worry about this. I don't worry. I'm using this as an object lesson for you. I can teach from what I know, my own experience. We're talking in this new digital age, something different. This YouTube is pretty new. Something different in the digital age. Brothers and sisters, today is Sunday. It's Sunday morning there. I pray you watch this. Go back and watch the first video. This is building on that. This is a sermon. I really love and appreciate all you guys who watch. And people have a right to believe whatever they want. You know, that's a free world, a free country in the United States, allegedly freedom of religion and all that, freedom of speech. Go for it. Believe whatever you want to believe. I'm, by the grace of God, teaching the truth as best as I can by the Spirit of God, by His leading. And I'm open to correction by the Lord or by, as I've mentioned before, servants of God, Christians who are not a Christian last week. 90% of the people that messaged me got saved last week. And now they're going to go be a prophet to Israel. They're trying to correct me on biblical doctrine. I haven't even read the Bible yet. 90%. You know, and what the Bible calls people like that? A fool. The Bible calls them a fool, not me. The Bible says they're a fool. So, brothers and sisters, if you are a mature Christian, I ask you to pray for Joshua's ministry. Pray for me to continue to do God's will, and I will pray for you. Send me your prayer request and your suggestions on any topic, even doctrines and all that, if you're a mature Christian. I'm a truth seeker just like any. I'm a truth seeker. That's why I'm not, you know, I got ordained with an independent group. I turned down ordination with the Assemblies of God, even though I agree with almost all their doctrine. I basically agree with all their doctrine. I turned it down. Why? Because I'm not going to be owned by men. You don't know how many people who are pastors in these different denominations, Baptist, Assemblies of God, whatever, who message me, and it's either please men, please the denomination, or please God. And then, well, this is my income. I mean, that's what they do. I've seen it 100 times. Or more than 100 times, preachers told me themselves that they're dealing with pleasing man, pleasing the denomination, or doing what God's leading them to do. And that's the fight. And I think God, because of my prophetic ministry, God led me from the very beginning to say no to denominations. Praise God for that. Because it's all about pleasing that group and pride of that group and advancing that group. Instead of advancing Jesus' kingdom, they advance the kingdom of their denomination. I've seen it in the Assemblies of God. I've seen it in Baptist, Bible Baptist, Southern Baptist. Of course, Catholicism. I mean, that's the ultimate example of church gone wild. I mean, you know, they've got girls gone wild. That's church gone wild. Roman Catholicism is an extreme. And then, of course, all those old mainline Protestant denominations. They've really gone wild with sodomy and everything else in these last days. Anyway, brothers and sisters, love you guys. I hope you have a blessed day. And in America, you know, it's recognized as a day of rest. It's recognized as the, lots of people incorrectly call it the Sabbath day. It should be called the Lord's Day, the day of the resurrection of our Lord, the first day of the week, Sunday. And most people use the idea of a rest day for that. I pray that you rest today. I pray that you spend the day seeking the Lord and honoring Him. Spending time with your family if you don't have time during the week, and enjoying, as Jesus said, that of course He's talking about Saturday, the Sabbath, but for us, the Lord's Day is given unto man, you know, is for man, it's benefit, for the joy and benefit of man, not man for the benefit of the Sabbath, but Sabbath is given for the benefit of man. So enjoy this day that the Lord has made, and be glad in it. Rest up. God bless you guys. Don't let anybody get you all wound up. Don't let anybody knock you off your the rock. Stay abide in Christ. Stay in Christ. Be hid in Christ. Because we are living in perilous times, brothers and sisters. I mean, like I say, we have peace in Christ. It's not about getting all fired up and drinking 10,000 cups of coffee. I keep mentioning that because of the danger of these things. People getting all fired up, running around saying, you know, the boy who cried wolf, you ever heard of Chicken Little and the sky is falling? That's what's on YouTube, all this Chicken Little stuff. Oh, the RFID chip's going to be mandatory in March 2013. Blah, 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 the sky is falling. No, it's not. Oh, Comet ISO, it's splitting apart, it's doing this, it's doing that. Comet Elenin, all this stuff is, and then when it doesn't come to pass, then it's making a mockery of Christianity. That's the problem. But the people who are doing it, some of them, particularly one, it's just to advance their own kingdom, make themselves famous, to sell books, whatever they're trying to do, promote themselves. That's the danger. I don't know why Christians have no discernment in these last days. I'll never know why people have no discernment. It's all these, you like somebody or not. They never see it as, does God want to hear this? Does God like it? It's always, oh, he's just such a nice guy. He's leading people to the Lord. How can you lead people to the Lord when you never give the gospel? You're not preaching the gospel. How are you leading someone to the Lord? Faith comes by hearing the word of God. When you're just, you don't get saved by hearing the bad news of the world. You get saved by hearing the good news, the gospel.